what I'll be discussing is, as said, is development through the lens of health. And what I'd like to do is just first really emphasize the importance that health has in development and development has in health. There's a very clear, strong, positive correlation between the two. And in order to really highlight that, I'd like to show a few graphs. There we go. A number of you probably know of Hans Rosling. He's a Swedish professor and has done brilliant work at sourcing and compiling data in a way that allows for it to be much more accessible and quite compelling in terms of describing situations and describing them over time. So what I'd like to show you from his website, it's called gapminder.org for those who don't know, is some correlations between health and wealth. The first one that we're looking at is life expectancy on the vertical axis and income per person or GDP per capita. And the circles that you see are countries, and the size of the circles is dependent on the size of the population. And then the color is indicating its regions. So you have the Americas, Europe and Central Asia, the East Asian Pacific, and then Sub-Saharan Africa. So the first journey that we'll take is from about the early 1800s, and it's looking at life expectancy in relation to income per person. And what you'll see is that as time passes, the European countries gain some momentum in terms of income, and bit by bit start having higher life expectancies. The life expectancies at the beginning were between about 25 and 45 years, and as time passes, bit by bit they increase. Eventually, you'll see the Asian countries also coming up to speed with an increase in income per person and also life expectancy. You'll note that as time passes, the sub-Saharan African countries in blue take quite some time before they start increasing in their life expectancy and increasing in their income per person. By the time the data reaches 2013, you'll note that there's quite a variation between the wealthiest and the poorest. And what else is also interesting in this is that a number of the poorest countries are in sub-Saharan Africa, and the spectrum shows a couple of things. It's interesting to note that in the Americas and the other regions, that there's quite a variation within regions. And this is extremely important when you're thinking about development, because if you're coming up with regional policies, you're not going to be taking into consideration the fact that there is quite a wide variation within within these regions. The other interesting point is that there is an overlap between regions. Quite often, we are saying that this is a developing area, this is a developed area, but it's not necessarily the case. You have to see it along a continuum, and when thinking about policy, when thinking about models and implementation strategies, just realize that there has to be much more nuance built into it. And the other point, and Ian spoke to this in his speech, is that within each country, you're going to be seeing a variation. So if we took Nigeria as an example, and it was plotted out similarly, you would also see quite a variance between the poorest of the poor and the wealthiest. So just to really drive the point home, what I'd like to do is also have a look at child mortality compared to GDP per capita. And it'll show us a similar pattern. I'll just speed it up so I have extra time. So coming from around the 1800s, the data that was available, you see very high child mortality rates, that's along the y-axis or the vertical axis, and lower income along the x-axis. And then when you start moving it again, you'll start to see that the income increases in Europe and in North America. And then it takes some time before Asian countries are catching up. And as the income is increasing, you'll also note that the child mortality is decreasing. Eventually, you'll start to see quite a decrease, particularly in the countries with greater income. And eventually, the Asian countries do do catch up to some point. But the sub-Saharan African countries, again, lag behind with in terms of income and also in terms of in terms of child mortality. They still have incredibly high child mortality. Like the other graph, it has the same characteristics of the spread, the overlap, and the variation between regions. And then one more slide. Health is not just it's not just about wealth. It's not just about the absence of disease. It's way more complex than that. And so just to give an example of that, what I thought I would do is show child mortality, but in this time in relation to the number of children per woman. So you see a high child mortality and a relatively high number of children per woman in the world in the early 1800s. And then as time passes, what you'll see is what you would expect, that as the number of children reduces per woman, there's a drop in child mortality. So again, it's the same pattern as before. It's Europe and North America that are leading. Asia follows behind that. And then behind that, you'll see sub-Saharan Africa. And this again highlights the importance not only of looking at health when considering development, but considering all the different components that impact on health. The bottom line is that that any of these solutions linked must be taken into consideration. And if data is not enough to prove that, then I would like to appeal to the moral imperative, and that is, as global citizens, as a global society, we have a duty to respond to the suffering of others. It doesn't matter where somebody's from, who they are, what their political belief, their religious belief, what their ethnicity or nationality. We have a responsibility, and there, if we have things that we can do and support collaboratively, then we should really be doing that. I worked with Dignitas International recently. It's a small Canadian medical and research organization. And when Dignitas started in 2004, it went to Malawi and was confronted by a massive amount of death and illness related to HIV. And this is one of the reasons why you see the sub-Saharan Africa in the position it's in. It's because of the level of disease, including HIV, that countries have faced. As one of the poorest countries, Malawi was devastated. HIV was really a death sentence in 2004. The population was about 12 million. 1 million were infected, and yet only about 3,000 people had access to antiretrovirals in 2004. The rest were doomed. The healthcare was collapsing with the burden of the AIDS patients, and not only was the healthcare collapsing, but among those who were dying, there were health staff, so there was a high volume of patients and fewer staff to actually treat them. The country was not only losing its health system, it was losing those who were economically most productive, and children were losing parents, and HIV just spread unchecked. Now, 10 years forward, 10 years later, and this is the result of a real commitment by the government, the government's partners, both nationally and internationally. The death rate has been reduced by nearly half. The number of people infected each year has also reduced by half. And instead of 3,000 people on treatment, there's nearly 500,000 people in Malawi receiving antiretroviral therapy. So there has been quite a success. Having said that, there's still a huge amount more to be done. Just make the point on a more personal level, one of the staff in Dignitas, her husband was a college professor, and he fell ill with AIDS. At the time, she was tested and found to be diagnosed with HIV as well. And this was in 2004 when there was no treatment available. So she had to nurse, she was a nurse herself, she had to nurse her husband through to his death. And when he passed away, she became a single mother of five children who had HIV and had no job. So fortunately for Dignitas, this is when we met her. She has been one of the most dedicated staff in the organization and been an extremely important role model. She stepped forward, although there was a huge stigma for HIV at that point because there wasn't much accessibility for treatment. She stepped forward and disclosed her status, and she used that to really encourage others to step forward, to gain treatment, and to be strong for them. She was a real beacon. She was also very innovative in coming up with a healthcare worker program that allowed for healthcare workers to receive treatment in a more confidential, quiet way, because healthcare workers at that point, they noticed, were not stepping forward. They were feeling the pressure of their role versus the stigma that was around them. So The thing that strikes me about this is that development aid, it can work, particularly for those who are directly benefiting. However, it takes time, and I really want to stress that it takes time. And there are certain conditions that need to be in place, which are often either overlooked or just simply ignored. The greatest need tends to be in places that are most difficult. And this includes places where there's war, violence, oppression, and corruption. Even in situations where governing authorities are genuine in their interest to move populations forward, particularly in the most impoverished countries of the world, there are so many challenges that can limit the impact of sustainable aid. Just to walk through some of them, there can be insufficient staff or other resources. Staff may not have access to training or benefits like salaries. The infrastructure may be poorly resourced. Transportation may or may not exist. And if it does, it may not be affordable for people to use. Roads can be dilapidated to the point of impeding access, particularly in rainy seasons. Fuel shortages are not uncommon. Power cuts, okay, three minutes, power cuts, and along with a number of other things. And when you combine this with poor health and nutrition and an exacerbation from weather events, which are increasing, things like flooding and drought, any genuine effort on any part will only have a nominal impact. And I think all you have to do is look at the Ebola outbreak in Western Africa to see that. Liberia, Guinea, and Sierra Leone, they really struggled to get control of Ebola. This resulted in a horrific situation that took quite some time to reduce the number of cases and was really a result of weak systems. The countries that managed to control the disease were countries that had stronger healthcare systems. But to build healthcare systems takes time, and quite often governments, institutional funders, and private donors aren't willing to give that kind of time. People want to see things change and change fast. They want to think that their money has gone for this huge impact on something that is new. This is contrary to what is often needed. What is needed is to really take the time and to do things in a way that allows for meaningful results to be reached. This is also difficult because what happens is when the expectations aren't in line with the reality, then quite often people will start to sway from what really needs to be done. Organizations feel this pressure. Sometimes the organizations even feed into it by the way that they communicate. They know that they have to put their best foot forward in order for their organization to get the resources that are required. And this combination creates an expectation which is truly impacting in a negative way on the capacity of organizations to really do what is necessary. So I think the main issue is that health has to be considered. It is so extremely important when you're talking about moving a population forward to a better space and higher levels of development. And in that, there has to be a very realistic view to what is possible, and that includes knowing and understanding the constraints, but it also includes giving the time that's required.